Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The Executive Director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill O'Brien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Well, thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome to this Tuesday edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Today, we are at the middle of the month of January. Today is the 15th day of January in the year 2019. It is a pleasure to be with you. I apologize for the fact that we're 9 minutes late getting started today, but had a little bit of technical difficulties, and I do believe it was on my end. I don't know what it was. I don't know what I did, but I must have done something because all of a sudden everything started to work. But anyway, so even though we are late, we are on live, and I do thank you for your continued support of the program and for your continued support of the Head On Radio Network. It's been a while since we have been on the air live. I was unable to do a program yesterday, a live program, and I kind of apologize for that, but we are here today, and I am looking forward to spending the better part of 2 hours, what's left of the 2 hours. We've eaten up about 10 minutes of it already. But it is a pleasure to be with you again. We do encourage you to participate even more actively in the program than listening itself involves. And I am aware that active listening and concentration is work. So that is participation. So please don't misunderstand me. I don't want to suggest that if you don't call, then you're not participating, because I know that many of you are. I got a wonderful email after our last program at the end of last week from a listener in California. I believe it was Matt. Who talked about how much he was enjoying the programs, and he gets them on a delayed basis, and because he works. And obviously, when we start at 1 p.m. here in the East, it's 10 a.m. in the West, and obviously everybody's working. And in fact, many of the people that are listening here in the East from 1 to 3 p.m. are at work as well. So Matt's email was his effort to kind of explain that an awful lot of people at this time in the middle of the day are unable to listen live. And I do appreciate that, and I understand that. And over the years, we've not let that deter us. And I continue to get a number of emails from people who indicate that even though they're listening to the programs on a delayed basis, they do listen to them, and I sure do appreciate that, as I appreciate every one of you. If you would like to call in and share your thoughts with us on the air about some of the issues we're dealing with or will be dealing with, then by all means, we invite you to do that. We've got two numbers that will get you into the Head On Radio Network studios. Bob and Agnes are both there today, and one of them will get you connected, and you'll be on the air immediately. The two phone numbers are as follows. They are both the same area code number, 304. And the first one is area code 304-574-8178. That's 304-574-8178. The other number is area code 304-640-2829. That's 304-640-2829. If you would like to communicate directly with me, either by email or through our Facebook page, I would be more than honored to hear from you. My email address is waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906, at gmail.com. So once again, that's lowercase, waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906, at gmail.com. Or another way that you can communicate directly with me is via the Facebook page. If you go to Facebook and in the search box at the top of the homepage, type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, and you'll be onto our Facebook page. and you can click on any of the postings that are there. And at the end of each posting, there's a comment box or link. And if you click on that comment link, you'll be able to send a communique directly to me via that Facebook page. I will get a notice on my Facebook account that someone has commented on one of the postings, and Facebook will immediately take me to that particular posting and to your comment. And, you know, based on what your comment is and its subject and its topic, we'll, you know, more than likely try to get your share your thoughts with you on the air. You know, if I mentioned the email that I got from Matt, and Matt was a little bit concerned because he felt like I was, you know, kind of concerned that there weren't live listeners out there. And his explanation, of course, was that he's at work. And so, therefore, he has to listen in the evening after the program is over or the next day. So he's usually running a day behind, as it were. But as he pointed out, that, you know, that doesn't at all detract from his appreciation of the program. And I sure appreciated his the effort he took to say that and let me know that. But also, what he was trying to do was help me out a little bit and explain as to why we didn't get more calls. And I do understand that at the height of the day. I'm a fan, for example, and you know, have been a fan for some time of Tom Hartman's program. Tom Hartman is on at the same time we are live. And so, by definition, on days that we broadcast, I can't hear Tom Hartman unless I pick it up later on delayed broadcast, on a delayed basis. And so, you know, I understand that many people are working, they can't listen at all. And some people who can listen are listening perhaps to Tom Hartman or to, you know, I know that most of our listeners aren't tuning into Rush Limbaugh or anything. I understand that because he's on at the same time as we are as well, of course. But anyway, welcome to the program. Welcome to this live program on the 15th day of January. I'd like to maybe begin by touching on a few bases with you because it's been 4 or 5 days since we've been together. Of course, as I speak, the hearings on the confirmation of the Attorney General nominee, Mr. Barr, William Barr, are ongoing. They're on the media is broadcasting them all live. I saw a little bit of it earlier, a couple of hours ago. And of course, it's a very important appointment because this is the most important office holder in our entire judicial, in our entire legal or justice system. And what I've seen so far are affirmations of commitment on the part of the nominee to not to do anything if he's confirmed, to interfere with the Mueller investigation. And there's been some question of that because Mr. Barr authored a memo in 2017 which was very critical of the Mueller investigation, of the president and the whole Russian connection. Fact of the matter is this Russian issue continues to garner attention. Every time we think that the issue has died down, it pops its little head up again. Over this past 3 or 4 days, there have been two major pieces of news on the president's alleged connections with Russia. One of them appeared in the Washington Post, the other in the New York Times. One of them basically speaks to the fact that it has been evidence has surfaced that President Trump went out of his way to keep any information on his meetings or conversations with Vladimir Putin private, to the point that he even requested that the notes taken by his interpreter be given to him, and he committed the interpreter to silence on the topics that were discussed in the meeting with Vladimir Putin. So, you know, this particular issue, it seems to me, inflames or reinflames, if you want to call it that, the whole issue of the president's connections to Russia, because the allegations or the implications are that if he's going to these lengths to hide information as to what the conversations were about, even from his own staff, even from his own State Department, even from, you know, from his own advisors, then it becomes impossible for them to give him any guidance, advice, information, or anything else, since they don't know what's going on or what he's been talking about. This is obviously something that has never happened before, but again, I think we're used to that in the Trump administration after better than 2 years. But the fact of the matter is, this is unprecedented. And it really poses a danger. Only one person knows what's being discussed, what commitments might have been made, et cetera, et cetera. The other story, which is, I believe, the Washington Post story. No, I believe this is the New York Times one. And basically, the story broke toward the end of last week, as I remember, or going into the weekend, that the FBI, with the firing of James Comey in 2017, launched a counterintelligence investigation against, focused principally on President Trump, whether in fact President Trump was possibly an agent, witting or unwitting, of the Russian government. And so to suggest that members of the FBI, who are experts in this field, were worried enough and concerned enough about the behavior of the president that they launched an investigation is incredible. I don't think there's anything else that you could say that would better describe it. Obviously, President Trump's supporters, principally leaders in the Republican Party, I'm thinking of Lindsey Graham specifically, jumped on it and talked about the fact that to conduct an investigation like this on the President of the United States is unheard of and is abuse of power and all these other things. On the other hand, the other side of the coin is that if this were anybody else but the president that was guilty of the kinds of behavior and things related to Russia that have already happened and then become public, then the FBI would be derelict in its obligations to the security of the nation if it didn't conduct such an investigation. And of course, through all of this, the shutdown goes on. And it doesn't seem to be anywhere near resolution. I've heard a number of proposals, and each side is blaming the other. President Trump is going out of his way to blame the Democrats for the shutdown. But the fact of the matter is, at least in the surveys that have been been done so far, most of the blame among the general public, among the citizenry, is being placed on the president and on Republicans for this. And so the thinking is, on one side, on the Democratic side, that if this really starts to cost the Republicans enough of them will defect in order to force the president to make some sort of compromises. That's the thinking. The other factor, or the other thing that many people believe might bring this shutdown to an end, is the pain that it's causing, not only for the 800,000 people who are not being paid, some of them, many of them, working, required to work for no pay, TSA agents and the rest. The fact of the matter is, the spinoff from the shutdown is beginning to affect people other than the particular workers laid off and their immediate families. Yesterday, there was a report, for example, about subsidies to owners of HUD housing and the fact that those subsidies are not coming through. And also the fact that support or subsidies in food as well as housing are being delayed. I know, for example, of a case where a person who regularly receives food subsidies was really in a bind this past weekend because the subsidies were not added to his account and he was not able to buy food. So the thinking is that the more of these kinds of stories that surface, the more the president is going to be compelled to do something about the shutdown. I heard a Republican this morning, very articulate. I can't remember who exactly it was, but the position or the argument that the person made was rational, was very rational. Didn't seem to be too politically driven at all. And his position is that there's going to have to be concession on both sides. Either both sides are going to have to find a way to win, or both sides are going to have to acknowledge that they each lost. But something has to bring this thing to an end. It's having international implications. It's making us look absurd before the world. It's sure as hell, if there's any confidence in us left in the world, this is shaking the last bit of that confidence that might be left. So in a sense, it seems that this thing has to come to an end. As this person commented, there obviously are going to be parts of the border where construction of some sort of wall or barrier or whatever is probably going to be appropriate. But at the same time, there are going to be other places where that's not true. And the president's going to have to realize that as well as the other side. But the point is, something needs to be done to bring this to an end, to a head, because it is making us look absurd. I mean, this is unbelievable. The fact that the government now has been shut down for close to almost a month. I think we're in the 25th day or maybe the 26th day. I can't remember. I was counting there for a while because I didn't think it would go on. But, you know, and then one more piece of information that on another issue that I thought I would just mention to you, which I think is significant, is that a federal judge in the New York Circuit has blocked the Trump administration and its Commerce Department under Wilbur Ross from adding the citizenship question to the 2020 census. And not only was the question itself gone, you know, or deleted, if you want to use that word, but the behavior of Wilbur Ross, the Commerce Secretary, was berated by the judge. The argument being that Wilbur Ross made so many errors and so many missteps in this whole process that his behavior was unforgivable. And so this is probably going to launch another issue or another battle. In fact, the judge commented in his decision that the plaintiffs have a solid enough case that the question should not be added to the 2020 census. On the other hand, the evidence is not strong enough to support the case of the of the litigants that what the Commerce Department was doing in trying to add the question was discriminatory against immigrants and people of color and the rest. And the judge made the comment that part of the reason that that evidence is not substantial enough to support the discriminatory allegations is because of the So therefore, there's no testimony from him, which would be which could comprise or form the basis for evidence. So because Wilbur Ross, through the efforts of the Supreme Court, was told he didn't have to testify before Congress, that basically meant that the evidence necessary to prove discrimination was not available. I think this is an important decision. And I think, you know, very honestly, I think I mentioned this the last time we did a live program last week, and I believe it's worth mentioning again. We tend to be, after the Kavanaugh hearings especially, and even after the appointment of Neil Gorsuch last year, we tend to be operating on the assumption, and I think there's a lot of validity for doing that, that the court has become political, too political, that it's totally controlled by the different political sides, that the conservative majority will always find with and for President Trump on everything that comes before it. And the fact of the matter is the evidence, the way that the particular justices have voted on particular issues tends to reinforce that, but not absolutely. And I think what we've got to realize or appreciate or hope for, maybe is a better way to put it, is that these justices will accept the fact, realize the fact, and behave accordingly, that they are justices of the Supreme Court, and their job is to interpret the constitutionality of statute law. Even though they may have become more political than they should be, I'm hoping that it's too early to say that they've become total political hacks. They are still jurists. They are still legalists. If they are appointed to the Supreme Court or even to the district and circuit courts, they are professionals in their field. And the fact that they have been appointed to these posts seems to validate or confirm the fact that they've got professional experience and professional credentials which warrant such an appointment. In order to behave politically 100% of the time, these people would have to ignore or act contrary to their professional responsibilities. I think we have to hope that these people are professional enough that they won't do that. I think, personally, in terms of the Supreme Court, for example, that if there's a swing vote on the court right now, or the potential for a swing vote on the court right now on many issues, it's going to be with the Chief Justice. But that doesn't mean that the Chief Justice is a centrist. He never was, he never will be. But he's a jurist. And he's a member of the Supreme Court. He's Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. And he's held that post for 13 years, as I think 13 is correct. And so what that means is that he has an affection for and responsibilities to his role as Chief Justice and to the court, which take precedence over his political and ideological preferences. He has indicated in a number of speeches that that's the way he feels and that's the way he intends to behave. Until he doesn't, I think we have to abide by that. And as long as Justice Stevens was a potential swing vote on the court, the Chief Justice often voted with the conservative majority. But now that Stevens is gone and replaced with Justice Kavanaugh, I think that places even a greater responsibility on the Chief Justice. And of course, many of you are aware, as I have been over the last couple of weeks, that there are all sorts of rumblings of the potential for another Supreme Court fight. And I've heard a number of commentators make the point that if there's a third opportunity for President Trump to nominate a justice to the Supreme Court, as bad as the Kavanaugh confirmation hearings were, this third one would be worse. While most of the attention has focused on Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg because of the cancer surgery, the lung cancer surgery that she had some time ago, all indications are that in spite of the fact that she's very advanced in age and has become extremely feeble, her mind seems to be operating perfectly, and she basically shows no signs of stepping away. She's working from home right now. She's missing out on the oral arguments. She's communicating via phone, I guess. But the fact of the matter is, when asked, she says that she's going to continue serving as a justice on the Supreme Court, and that she'll know when it's time to step down, but that time is not now. And there was a story that surfaced last week related to the possible, remote possibility, I think, but possible, decision by Clarence Thomas to retire while Trump is still in office, in order to guarantee that his replacement would be a conservative. Obviously, Thomas is looking toward the future. He's in his 60s. I believe he's 62. I don't think he's that far into his 60s, but he is in his 60s. And so he's probably seeing that his time on the court does have an end to it. And politically, and of course, if all of this is true, if he's actually thinking this way, then that indicates just how political the man is, that he would make a decision or consider making a decision to retire early in order to guarantee that the person who replaces him is somebody that he's comfortable with. So, but anyway, that's out there as well. So anyway, those are the issues that I've noted over the last 4 or 5 days that I wanted to at least mention. I would be deficient. I would feel that I was being deficient if I didn't at least mention a few of these issues. There are a number of issues or considerations that I'd like to address in today's program. There are a couple. Some of them are major, and I'd like to address a number of them. One of them deals with the issue of education, which I think in our last program is the issue that we spent most of our time on. I've been working over the last 3 or 4 days trying to put some ideas and thoughts together on this issue of education. I almost feel obligated to try to do something, because it seems like over the past week, maybe, issues related directly to education, to higher education, to the relationship between education and economic development have surfaced, principally, of course, where I am on the state level. But I really do believe that we're caught in a dilemma as far as education is concerned. And I think, I really believe that I might have something to contribute to that conversation. So that's what I've been spending my time on. I want to share a few of those thoughts with you in today's program. I've also picked up on a couple of pieces over, you know, of course, I've, you know, continued to stay up with the issues of the day. And there are a number that I wanted to share with you. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this article, but since we're down to about a little bit less than 20 minutes in the rest of our first hour, and looking at the clock, we're at 41 minutes after the hour. So we've got 19 or 20 minutes before we pause for a break between the 2 hours of our time together today. So maybe this particular hour, or this particular issue, is perfect to raise first, only because we can probably take, get into it and actually finish it during this first hour. In other words, maybe the time right now, because we have 19, 18 minutes left, is pretty much suggesting that this might be the best issue to begin with. Let me tell you a couple of things ahead of time. It's about, obviously, what's going on nationally in terms of our politics. It deals with the Trump presidency, of course, as almost every editorial, every op-ed piece, and every major publication has over the last 2 years and continues to do. This one deals directly with the shutdown, and more specifically with the president's behavior in dealing with Democratic leaders in trying to find a way to address the shutdown. Up until the November elections, the Republicans controlled all the branches of government, both houses of Congress. But after the 2018 midterms, the Democrats are now solidly in control of the House of Representatives. So that means that whatever President Trump decides to do in relationship to the wall, to the border, to the shutdown, he's going to have to find a way to work with Nancy Pelosi and the Democratic leadership in the House. And as we know, last week in one of these meetings, you know, theoretically, which was called at the White House to potentially end the shutdown, the president walked out of the meeting in a huff. Some of the Republicans deny that his behavior was that abrupt. But Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer, who were there, claim that the president banged the table, got up and walked out of the room in a huff and said, basically, he asked Nancy Pelosi specifically, are you willing to appropriate money for border security, which will include money for the wall? And she said straight up, no. And President Trump, reportedly at this point, said, then this meeting is over, banged the table in disgust, got up and walked out. There were others in the room. The vice president was in the room. He denied that that's what happened. He blamed the Democrats for the end of the meeting and said that, in contrary to the stories, that the president lost his temper and walked out, the president brought candy to everybody for the meeting. Anyway, that's what this article is about. It is an article written by the History News Network. It's dated yesterday, January 14th, 2019. And it basically uses history in order to lay out a situation similar to the one we're in now. I want to recommend this article to you because I think, for historical reasons, it's a superb article. And it raises cautions. In fact, the people who wrote it, and the History News Network has taken credit for this article, and there are several historians mentioned in the article. So there's not one name, not one author that's associated. But the fact of the matter is, the similarities that one sees between historical situations and the present, in the present, are significant and worthy of attention. But at the same time, you can't push that too far, and I think this article acknowledges that. It says, yet as much fun as it is to draw parallels between the events of the 17th century and our current predicament, we must avoid the overly extended metaphor. President Trump is not Charles I, and obviously the main thrust of this article is about the early 17th century during the reign of Charles I of Great Britain. And basically what the article is doing is cautioning us not to make more of this than we have a right to. But at the same time, the similarities are incredible, and the information, the historical information in the article, it seems to me, makes it worth reading. I highly recommend it. The title is, quote, Trump's downfall is all but certain because his tantrums follow this predictable historical pattern. And basically what this article does is establish historical precedents for situations and behaviors of executives in the past which have engaged in the same kind of tantrums that seems to be driving the president to refuse to compromise on this shutdown. And therefore, based on historical precedents, predicts that all things being equal, this kind of behavior is one of the things that's going to bring this presidency down. But I caution, all things aren't equal. So you've got to be careful pushing the similarities too far. But let me share, just to give you a flavor of what's in this article, let me share a paragraph or two with you. King Charles I of England frustrated at the limitations of his otherwise powerful position, decided to dissolve Parliament in March of 1629. Many of us who remember our history know that. That Charles I dissolved Parliament and determined to rule England without Parliament because it was opposing him. And once he decided to dissolve Parliament in March, along with it was a decision to clap several of the opposition's leaders in irons, arrest leaders of his opposition. The monarch had come to an impasse over issues as lofty as religious conformity, as mundane as regulations concerning tonnage. Eventually, Charles I found it easier to simply dissolve the gathering than to negotiate with them. I think the similarity to what's happening now with the shutdown is obvious. Historian Michael Braddock explains, and this is a quote, "The king was not willing to assent to necessary measures in governance. Instead, he was intent on upholding his right to withhold consent as he saw it, believing that without that power, he was no longer a king in a meaningful sense. Charles," the article says, "was a committed partisan to the idea of the divine right of kings. He truly believed himself to be ennobled, to have the right to rule by fiat. And regarding legislators, at best as an annoyance, at worst as actively contravening the rule of God." That's what the divine right of kings is about. The idea or the argument that the king is God's representative on earth, and therefore his power is absolute, because to question the king's power is to question God. Charles believed this. He took it seriously. He didn't believe that Parliament had the right to block him on anything. He didn't believe that as king, he should have to compromise with anybody on anything. And so therefore, he saw his opponents as his enemies and acted accordingly. And again, I think the similarities are striking. Though it was legally required to levy taxes, at this point in history, Parliament was always only an occasional institution. This was the fourth Parliament that Charles had dissolved. Yet separation of powers still made it impossible for the king to directly collect taxes of his own accord. And so he adopted means of shuffling numbers around to draw income into the treasury. This was what in this period was called the period of personal rule, and to critics, 11 years tyranny, in which Charles's power became ever more absolute. Once he abolished Parliament, he didn't have to answer to anybody. And this 11-year period before the Civil War, which would overthrow him, is called the 11 Years' Tyranny. Royalists, this article says, supporters of the king, may have seen the dissolution of Parliament as a political victory. Yet the ultimate loss would be Charles's, to spectacular effect. Historian Diane Perkis explains that events that were ultimately to lead to the Civil War were set in motion by a royal tantrum, unquote. And that's, of course, reference to the title of the article itself, which is about President Trump's tantrums. And then the article goes on to talk about royal tantrums. And it says that royal tantrums are very much on all of our minds right now in this new year, as we approach the fourth week of the longest government shutdown in U.S. history. As the state coffers of England were depleted after Parliament was dissolved and continued sovereignty required creative means of reorganization, redefinition, and shifting funds, so too do we find government agencies forced by extremity to demand work of essential workers without pay. Garbage is piling up in federal parks and at the National Mall. TSA agents and air traffic controllers are working for free. Yet the president, under the influence of right-wing pundits, refuses to end this current shutdown. Nancy Pelosi explains President Trump's behavior as kind of a manhood thing. And thus we have the similarity. I especially wanted to get into touch on this piece to share with you one of the quotes that is included in this article. I had never seen it before, and I think it is absolutely delightful. It's from John Milton, poet, pamphleteer, who was writing in 1649 on Charles I. And Milton says that that monarch, Charles I, ruled us forcibly by laws to which we ourselves did not consent. And then Milton denounced the royalists, those who continue to support the king in spite of his behavior. And, of course, the message here is Mitch McConnell and the Republican leadership and their refusal to hold anything that President Trump does or says to account. Here's John Milton. He denounced the royalists as, quote, an inconstant, irrational, an image-doting rabble who were determined to make the kingdom great again and who are, quote, like a credulous and hapless herd begotten to servility and enchanted with these popular institutes of tyranny, unquote. Milton's comparison, or Milton's allegations against the behavior of Charles I and against the royalists who supported him is used as a biting indictment of the behavior of Donald Trump and the behavior of those Republican leaders who continue to support him. And, of course, I mentioned Mitch McConnell for obvious reasons. There's no question that if a bill to end the shutdown came before the United States Senate today, it would overwhelmingly pass because leaders in both parties want this shutdown to end. The Republicans realize that it's hurting them. They're getting the blame. And a number of them are up for re-election in 2020. And the longer this thing goes on, the more in jeopardy their re-election is. So they have a vested interest in ending this thing. And it seems clear that if any kind of a proposal to bring the shutdown to an end made it to the floor of the United States Senate, it would pass. It would pass with the huge vote that it would need, 60 votes, to pass. It is only Mitch McConnell who's keeping that from happening. He refuses to let any bill come to the floor of the United States Senate that he says the president will not sign. What that means is the president is controlling the behavior of the majority in the United States Senate. This is the party that has long claimed to support the idea of separation of powers and checks and balances. And this is the behavior that it exudes. This article then, and I know we're getting close to the top of the hour here, so I won't go, well, we're right at the top of the hour now. Maybe it'd be a good time to pause. Because we are right at the top of the hour. So I'm afraid if we go any further, we're going to be 8 to 10 minutes into the second hour, and I don't want to do that. So let's pause, and we'll take a 4 or 5 minute break right now. You're listening to the Virtual Center for Study. Some music for us. Agnes has been doing that, and a lot of people have commented on how much they're enjoying the music that she selects for us.
Well, thank you, Bill.
I'm hearing that all the time. My brother says that all the time. Where does she get that music? It's wonderful.
Oh, so, well, thank you. I tailor it to your show.
Well, aren't you nice? Thank you. Listen, we're going to pause, and we're going to hear a little of it. And we'll pause for about 3 or 4 minutes, and then we'll come back and get into our second hour. So please stay with us. We'll be right back.
We now return to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Here's your host, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Well, thank you, Agnes, and thank you for that absolutely fabulous music. It was great. I love that horn. Thank you. And I can't believe the connection, the audio connection we've got is so good. We couldn't get any, but I don't know what I did. I spit at it or something. I don't know. But
Bill,
anyway.
I think it's just Skype. Occasionally,
well,
it flares up like that. Check and see if there's any updates.
I don't like to blame it because it's usually me.
No, anyway. That time it wasn't. I was here. I know what happened.
Anyway, well, listen. Thank you, and welcome to our second hour here of today's edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Today, as we mentioned earlier, is the 15th day of January in the year 2019. We're right in the middle of the month. If you have just joined us, we thank you for that. If you've been with us through the first hour, then we thank you for staying tuned with us. Let me quickly share with you our phone numbers and invite you to come on the air with us and share your thoughts with us. I know we would love to hear from you, not just me, but I know our listeners would as well. We have two phone numbers, both of them same area code, 304. The first one, 304-574-8178. The second one, 304-640-2829. Or if you'd like to communicate directly with me, either by email or through our Facebook page, then you can do that. I would be honored to receive the communique from you. If it's an email, my email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. That's waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906@gmail.com. Or you can go to our Facebook page, facebook.com. In the top, at the search box, at the top of the homepage of Facebook, type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, and you'll be on to our Facebook page. And if you click on any of the postings, you scroll down and look at any of the postings on that Facebook page, each of them is followed by a comment button or link. And if you click on the comment link, that gives you the opportunity to communicate directly with me. Ostensibly, the idea was that it would be about that posting, but it doesn't have to be. The point is, we would love to hear from you. And in advance, let me again thank you for your continued support of the program and for your continued support of the Head On Radio Network. And I think all of everybody listening appreciates what Bob and Agnes and those guys do up there. It's just absolutely amazing how to me is magic. The whole thing is magic. And Bob is the wizard. Bob is the wizard of technology as far as Agnes and I are concerned. We both agree. I wanted to go back and finish, and again, I do want to complete the article we were looking at, but again, I do recommend it. If you go to the History News Network, it's dated the 24th of January. The title is Trump's Downfall is All But Certain because his tantrums follow this predictable historical pattern. And then basically the connection is made through a good portion of the article between the behavior of President Donald Trump and the behavior of Charles I of Great Britain and his decision in 1629 to essentially dismiss Parliament. And his argument is, belief was that rather than compromise, he didn't believe as king, as God's king on earth, that he should have to compromise with anybody. And rather than do that, and thereby in his own eyes diminish his own power, he determined to dismiss Parliament, arrest many of its leaders, see them as the enemies he believed they were, and rule the nation or the kingdom without Parliament, in violation of Parliament's right to exist under the British Constitution. We are now looking at a situation here where the president has threatened, although in the last 24 hours, he's kind of backed off on this threat, to declare a national security emergency at the border. And take money from wherever he can find it in the budget and build his wall and have the military do it. The Army Corps of Engineers. He said again yesterday, that he's not wanting to do that. He's uncomfortable doing that. But at the same time, he asserts that he has a perfect right to do it. If he did that, that would be a direct violation of the Constitution of the United States, because it would be doing an end run around Congress and Congress's right to control the purse and the president's responsibility to find ways to work with Congress. That's the way our constitutional system is set up. That's the system the people created or ratified. And that's the system that President Trump legally must find a way to operate within. So I think the last thing we looked at was that absolutely delightful quote by John Milton, not only on the behavior of Charles I, but his critical comments about the royalists who supported that behavior. I thought that quote particularly relevant in light of the behavior of the leaders of the Republican Party right now. I wanted to share this one last item from this article with you. And again, there's more to the article, and I do recommend it to you. It's just absolutely delightful. I loved it. But it's an account or a position on this on these particular issues by a political pollster named Kevin Phillips. The reason I'm pausing is because, believe me, this was a long time ago. But I went to high school with a classmate named Kevin Phillips, who graduated in the same year that I did. And Kevin went on to Harvard, and I've never seen him or spoke with him since. But I had heard that he had become a scholar of some note, and I'm just wondering whether this is him or not. But anyway, I don't know that, and I don't think it's relevant to what we're talking about. But in 1998, Kevin Phillips published a book which is entitled The Cousins Wars, Cousins, Religion, Politics, and the Triumph of Anglo-America. And in that book, Phillips argued that the English Civil Wars set a template for political conflict that continued, and that the conflicts between the 17th and 19th centuries could best be understood as being connected to one another. Saying, and this is a quote from his book, how three great internal wars seeded one another. The English Civil War laying the groundwork for the American Revolution, which in turn laid the groundwork for a new independent republic split by slavery that would be torn apart during the American Civil War. He's establishing a connection between these things around the same theme. And the same theme is the idea of two broad ideologies based on executive power. One ideology claims the right to rule almost as a king. The other ideology claims the right of the people to hold that king accountable. And Phillips's book argues that if you look at that theme, you can see it in each of these wars. The English Civil War, the American Revolution, and indeed our Civil War itself. And so therefore, to Phillips, Anglo-American history should be interpreted as a battle between two broad ideologies, which manifested themselves differently in each conflict, yet preserved the intellectual continuities with their forebearers. Phillips sees, and this I think is really interesting, this in fact on my printed copy, I wrote wow in the margin here because I think this is really significant. Phillips sees in Charles's claims of absolutism, the absolute right to rule under the divine right of king, and the idea of religious conformity, the arguments of King George III in the American Revolution. Phillips argues that there's really not much difference between the claims of royal absolutism of Charles I in the early 17th century and the claims to royal power of George III in the late 18th century. And Phillips sees a connection between both of those and the defenses for inequity offered by Southern planters in the American Civil War. Contrary to this, the parliamentarian sees the language of ancient liberties as embraced by the American revolutionaries, or the rhetoric of New England abolitionists in the antebellum era. The royalist position historically emphasizes order, hierarchy, and tradition, while the second emphasizes individualism, justice, equality, and liberty. Basically, then, what Phillips is arguing is a connection between the English Civil War, the American Revolution, and the American Civil War. And if it seems to me, and the article doesn't do this, I'm doing this, but it seems to me if you accept the premise of that argument, then what we're seeing today in the behavior of Donald Trump in his relationship with a new Democratic majority in the House of Representatives, the same kind of ideological differences being played out. And the issue is, how far will President Trump take his claim to absolute power to govern? How far will he push it? Even more important, how long will the Republican Party to continue to support him in doing that? That seems to be the key issue here. I think, for example, that there's really something to this. Let me give you just a quick reason why, and then we'll get into something totally different. The president has been in office for better than 2 years. the situation on the border in terms of illegals showing up and asking for asylum and entry into the United States, the traffic was much heavier than it is now. In other words, for the first 2 years of President Trump's time in office, there was no national security emergency at the border. The national security emergency didn't arise until the Democrats won control of the House. And suddenly, now that the president is forced to deal with opponents, now suddenly there's a national emergency at the border. And the president is seriously contemplating action that he might take to deal with it. It seems to me that that speaks to an attitude on the part of President Trump that is very similar to the theme of Kevin Phillips's book. That's why I've really wanted to share this article with you. I believed it was that significant. Anyway, there is much more to this article. In fact, the author of the article says, there's much that is convincing in Phillips's claims. Of parliamentarians was crucial in both revolutionary and antebellum New England in terms of crafting a language of rebellion. The Southern aristocrats and apologists of slavery during the American Civil War consciously compared themselves to Charles's Cavaliers, and Southern leaders rejected the creed as spelled out in the United States founding documents as evidence of heretical nonconformism. Thus, the article says, applying Phillips to the current divisions in the United States has a certain logic to it. If the American Revolution continued the same debates from the 17th century English Civil Wars, and indeed it did in part, and the American Civil War was born from the contradictions of the Revolution, which also is undeniably true, then it might follow that the current divisions in our country are a continuation of the American Civil War by other means. From this perspective, Donald Trump is a kind of Copperhead president, a Northern Confederate sympathizer, as argued convincingly by Rebecca Solnit in The Guardian. Wow. That's pretty heady stuff. I think it's a great, great article. It's one of those things that provokes thought. Once you read it, you keep thinking about it and thinking about it, then you leave it for a while, and suddenly you find yourself coming back to it. And you think about something else that strikes a note of similarity for you. I'd like to turn now to a topic that we dealt with, I believe, in our last program. And I'm going to review a little bit of it because it was so long ago. But it deals with the issue of education. And as I mentioned when we first came on the air today, I've spent quite a bit of time over the last couple of days writing and tearing things up and writing more and tearing things up, because I have this thesis going around in my head, which I want to share with you in the rest of the program today and really pursue this issue to its logical conclusion. I think there's a lot here, And I'll be honest with you, I want to cover it on the air today. Not only so you'll hear it and have the opportunity to react to it, but so I'll hear it as well. Because I really do believe that there's an issue here that is incredibly significant. As I mentioned, the issue deals with education, the challenges of education, and how teaching changes as part of that education. And this is something that we dealt with in our last program, and I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this. But if you remember, I ask you to begin this by kind of thinking along with me on an issue that I think all of us would have to agree, at least to a degree, we would agree with. And that is, if you ask people to name the best school teacher, the best teacher they ever had, invariably, they're going to choose a teacher that they had in elementary school. It just happens, rarely, that a middle or a high school teacher makes the kind of impression that lasts a lifetime. To be honest with you, or anything close to that. And then I mentioned that over the years, I've done these grants, and I've been teaching college and graduate classes for a number of years to teachers. And I've had the opportunity to confront teachers with this issue. I've asked them, why is it that elementary teachers always seem to get the nod? The best teachers invariably are elementary teachers. These teachers went to. And the one theme that all the responses seem to have in common is that they always look for explanations to students, never to teachers. And I find this interesting and a little bit disturbing, because it's almost like blaming poor people for problems with the economy, or suggesting that somehow poor people aren't living up to their responsibilities to not be poor. In other words, it's almost an example of blaming the victim. And in this particular case, when we talk about education and the numbers of people who have gone through the educational procedure that we've set up for them and found it wanting, for many, this has been the most horrendous experience of their lives. Some people never get over it. So for teachers to automatically assume that if an elementary teacher is the best teacher, then there are reasons for that. In other words, it ain't our fault. And as I mentioned, these reasons or explanations tend to range far and wide. A couple of teachers point to the issue of puberty, saying that when young kids enter adolescence and the hormones kick in, behavior problems emerge for teachers. And that this is the challenge that secondary teachers have to deal with that elementary teachers don't. That's one excuse. The other one is that after so many years of school, especially elementary, after elementary school. Kids get burned out with school. And when they enter middle school and high school and they start to get homework and there's work associated with it, many of these kids get burned out. And they kind of feel like they're stuck in something that they really didn't understand they were going to have to deal with. And then a third issue is the fact that secondary teachers have to wear a number of hats in the classroom at the same time. They have to be classroom managers. They have to be disciplinarians. And they also have to teach content, subject matter. And that makes the job of the secondary teacher difficult, which in part explains why these teachers are never the favorite teacher. And then you get changes in our society at large. The fact that teachers don't get the support from home that they used to get because societies experience a decline in the number of two-parent households. Also, secondary students are taught by a number of different teachers in the same day. In other words, once kids enter middle school, they begin to change classes and they go from class to class. And so at the end of the day, they have five or six different teachers. Whereas the elementary school student deals with one teacher all day. And so the relationship between student and teacher becomes closer. And students tend to look back fondly in their later years about particular elementary teachers that they were especially close to. And so many of these secondary school teachers will argue that it stands to reason the favorite teacher couldn't be one of five or six teachers you had every day and that same process went on year after year. How could any of those teachers qualify for your favorite teacher against elementary teachers that you had for the entire day? And then finally, there's the challenge of teaching content, subject matter, and the work that it's required, that it requires, and the fact that students resent that work. And so therefore, the job of the secondary teacher becomes more difficult. Those are just some of the explanations for this issue that I can remember from my own personal experience. I can remember teachers, I remember one teacher specifically saying that the warm and fuzzy experiences that young kids have in elementary school, you don't get that in high school. And kids miss that. And they look back fondly on their elementary years. And so when you ask them later on who their favorite teacher is, they'll always go back to that particular source. My conclusion is that the very range of these explanations confirms the legitimacy of the issue, the legitimacy of the question. Most of us have seen it. Students eager to learn in elementary school, where every other word out of their mouth seems to be why, by the time they get into middle and especially high school, become indifferent, dispassionate, alienated, often hostile. And they have little interest in what the classroom has to offer. And that's the challenge that the secondary teacher faces. Why is this issue significant? The issue seems to me important because of what it tells us about education. In other words, I'm going where the teachers don't go. They blame it on students. In other words, their answer to the dilemma lies with the student. My answer to the dilemma lies with the change in curriculum. the difference between being a student in elementary school and being a student in middle or high school. There's more to it, I've said, than meets the eye, much more. The very nature of what goes on in the classroom changes dramatically from elementary to secondary school. What we might best call learning as process in the lower grades becomes almost exclusively content-driven at the secondary level. Translation: in elementary school, everything that happens in the classroom seemingly emanates from something the students initiate. They ask questions. They ask the whys. They want answers. And that creates opportunity for the teacher to teach. In secondary school, we're not talking about anything that emanates from the students. We're talking about subject matter that comes from the outside, that is imposed on these kids. And that's a difference. For students, that means learning is no longer the pursuit of answers to questions they ask. Instead, teachers now ask all the questions. But these questions are not in response to a genuine desire to know that comes from students. But these questions measure how effectively the teacher delivered the content. No longer do right answers reflect student understanding or mastery of subject matter. That would demand more interest than most students have in the material, and would require greater depth than too many of our teachers can even deliver. Students rarely care enough about the subject matter being presented to them to fully engage it, even to ask questions about it. Evidence that the change from elementary to secondary is dramatic. As memory of earlier school years fades into the past, the word why is heard less and less in our classrooms. Beyond the earliest grades, students no longer drive the learning process. Teachers do. Education shifts from process to product. From an enterprise focused on development of the total student to one where subject matter dominates. What happens in the classroom is dictated by forces totally removed from and external to the student. Teaching changes from an enterprise committed to guiding students to formulate their own description of reality, to being exposed to descriptions of realities created by other people. Gone are the skills students once needed to turn imagination into creative reality. Gone also is the joy and excitement that defines active learning. In its place, a process that engenders little creativity and not much reality either. Challenging student encounters with the unknown and the help teachers can provide to design strategies to order and understand the unknown are over. They're gone. They're absent. And with it, the kind of excitement and sense of fulfillment that comes only with active student engagement in pursuit of answers to questions that they themselves raise. Then and only then is true learning experienced. That's the kind of education that John Dewey defined as life itself. What has replaced it after the fifth grade is what Dewey derisively called preparation for life. In today's vernacular, in today's language, that's training. Plato lays out the difference in his Republic. In the allegory of the cave, Plato insists, quote, that the power and capacity of learning exists in the soul already. If I'm right, Plato says, then certain professors of education must be wrong when they say that they can put a knowledge into the soul which was not there before, unquote. To believe that, Plato suggests, is to assume that man enters this world knowing nothing, that the human soul is indeed what John Locke would call tabula rasa, a blank slate, that everything a person knows is introduced, Plato says, into the soul which was not there before, like sight into blind eyes, unquote. What Plato dismissed as patently absurd in 375 BC defines precisely what we currently do in our classrooms, not for our students, but to them. We've redefined learning from cultivating the desire to know to being able to document knowledge, to pass off familiarity with information as understanding of it. Grades become education's principal outcome, not what grades are designed to measure. Education itself shifts from substance to the pursuit of a credential. That's why I think this issue is important. That's why I believe that this shift from elementary school to secondary school in the nature of curriculum is meaningful, because it involves a total shift in priorities. The student ceases to be the center of education and ultimately loses the center of consideration. Subject matter takes its place. But here's the issue that I think is significant. We're not talking here about a change that happens chronologically. In other words, we're not talking here about time. We're not talking here about a transition from elementary school to secondary school that is limited or defined exclusively by the shift from the lower grades to the upper grades. What's more important is what is involved in that shift and what we've done with it as educators. Because the principal issue that we're dealing with is the issue of class, not time. Let me be specific. And this is where I'm in search, because this is stuff I've not seen anywhere in my years of reading. It seems to me that we have to confront a reality of education and education history in this country, in the West. I don't believe anything has changed. Most people have believed, have long believed, that true education is only applicable to the few. But our system of government requires that all of our citizens be educated. But if you believe that everybody can't learn, that not everybody is educable, then there needs to be a difference in the kind of education you deliver. What I see is that we see the difference between education directed for the few and education demanded of the many in the transition from what we do in elementary school to what we do in secondary school. Education for the few, and we continue to have one of the best education system in the world, right up through our higher education, our colleges and universities, graduate and professional schools. And people who can afford it from around the world continue to send their kids to this country for their education. But it's education directed for the few on the assumption that only the few can really handle it, and the fact that the many cannot. So for the many, you got to have a totally different approach to education. And that's the shift to content. No longer is education focused on the needs and the abilities and the skills of students. Education has shifted and has become a means to discriminate among students, to separate the wheat from the chaff, the good students from the bad students. What Jefferson called the boy of best genius from the residue. I think Jefferson is an interesting phenomenon here, because not only did he come up with this plan to educate the masses for 3 years and 3 years only at public expense. And if education was to go on beyond the 3 years, then parents would have to pay for it. The state could no longer subsidize it. But for the few, for the brightest students, even students among the poor, among the masses, the state would continue to subsidize their education all the way up through the university level. And as we know, Jefferson was the principal architect for creation of the University of Virginia. And I don't mean only architect for the buildings. I meant architect of the curriculum. Jefferson wanted William and Mary to feature one of the toughest, most rigorous curriculums of any institution anywhere. He wanted the center of higher education to be Virginia, to be Charlottesville. it's pretty obvious that the same Jefferson never dreamed or didn't think for a minute that the masses of young people would qualify for admission into the University of Virginia. He knew that he was creating an institution for the few, for the best, for the brightest, and that the masses were being relegated to something quite a bit less than that. The kind of education that was more in tune with their abilities, their assumed abilities. As we look around today, as we continue to look for ways that our education system can support our economy, our economic growth, our economic expansion, the rapid change in technology and information that has given this period in history the name the Information Age. As we continue to do that, it seems to me we're confronted with a totally new problem that those in our past never had to deal with before. And that is the need to educate everybody. We cannot continue to assign a majority of our young people to inferior education anymore. Because the menial jobs available to them are not there anymore. All the jobs require technological expertise. They require education well beyond high school. They require skills. They require the kind of education that is going to prepare people, all people, for the challenging changes that are rapidly underway regularly in the world of work. That's what we call a skilled workforce, a well-educated workforce. How do you, as an educator, how do you educate somebody with the skills needed to fill jobs that aren't even created yet, that don't even exist yet? How do you know how to prepare students for that? You can't. All you can do is prepare students to teach themselves, to educate students to become self-taught. So when you hear the phrase lifelong learning, that's what we're talking about. Oftentimes it requires going back to schools for additional courses or refresher courses or whatever. But the fact of the matter is what it really requires is that our public schools, all of them, begin to teach kids how to learn. How to address problems, how to define problems, and how to solve them. How to do the research, to collect information, how to evaluate the information collected, how to distinguish between the most important information from the less important information. How to formulate possible answers to questions, to problems. How to test those answers, and remaining open to the idea that you might be wrong, that there might be something you're not considering. Here's the irony of ironies in this whole issue, it seems to me. the very skills that our economy is demanding are the same skills that operated on a reduced level in elementary school. It requires that we rediscover an approach to education which is based on the need to educate the whole student, and that education must be, teachers must be, able to respond to inquiries and questions and genuine concern that students have. Our teachers have to be more qualified, not less, because they're guiding learning. They're teaching students how to teach themselves, how to confront new information, how to evaluate it, how to organize it, how to order it, all of it. That's really the kind of education that we've continued to provide for the few. But from the very beginning, we've believed the poor or the masses can't handle. The fact of the matter is they can, if given the chance. Obviously, nobody believes that everybody can reach the same levels of achievement as everybody else. We are limited, all of us, by what we're born with. Our intelligence, our willingness to work, the happenstance of our birth, whether we're born into money or not, whether we're able to go to the best schools, whether we're able to afford tutors to get us into the best colleges and universities. All these things mean that everybody is can all reason. We can all solve problems. We function day to day in a complex world, and we learn how to do it. We teach ourselves how to do it. That's what we've got to begin doing in our classroom, is to teach students how to do that. To put the emphasis or the focus back on the students and less on subject matter. The fact of the matter is there's a way to do this. And so far, we have chosen not to do it. I believe we're afraid to do it. We've always believed in the security of teaching kids what we want them to believe. We've never been brave enough to educate our young people to decide for themselves what they believe. That's the hurdle we've got to get over. So I believe that the transition from elementary teaching to secondary school teaching, the shift from emphasis on the whole student and responding to the creative needs and interests and enthusiasm that young kids exude in the classroom changes when they get to secondary school. They couldn't say anything in elementary school, but why? They want to know. By the time they get into high school, they don't want to know anymore. They don't care. The fire has been doused. We've got to find a way to reignite that fire. And I believe we've got the way to do it. I believe there is a way to do it. And I'd like to maybe open tomorrow's program by sharing some of the answers to that dilemma with you. But I think we've just about reached the top of the hour. It's 1 minute. We're 59 minutes after the hour. So I think we've reached the end of our program today. Again, thank you so much for tuning into the Virtual Center today. I apologize for the delay at the outset. Hopefully when we come on tomorrow, we'll start right out of the box at our regular start time at 1 p.m. Eastern time. I hope that all of you have a wonderful, wonderful rest of this Tuesday. Enjoy each other. Hug the people you love, because you never know. And hopefully, all things willing, all things working the way we hope they will, we'll be back together again tomorrow. Thank you so very, very much. Have a good day.